Friends, the most important day of my life was the day I was ordained a priest. Sacerdos in Aeternum, the Church of Rome called it in those days, the days of Pope Pius XII. Sacerdos in Aeternum, in Latin, a priest forever in any language. The night before ordination, I was given this book. Its Latin title reads Missale Romanum, Roman Missal, Roman Mass Book. And, as was the case with everyone ordained before the Second Vatican Council Reformation, and that includes the Pope, all the cardinals, all the bishops, and most of the priests of today, as was the case with all of them, the ordaining bishop asked me to place my left hand on this book, raise my right hand, and take this solemn oath. I voluntarily and unreservedly accept all the apostolic and ecclesiastical traditions of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church of Rome. And I promise, vow, and solemnly swear to maintain and profess all those traditions unchanged until the last breath of my life. The most central and the most sacred of those traditions is the sacrifice of the Mass. The Mass of our forefathers, the traditional Latin Mass, sometimes referred to as the Tridentine Mass of Pope Pius V, because it was at the request of the Council Fathers who gathered between 1545 and 1563 in the Italian city of Trent, the Tridentine city. It was at the request of the Tridentine Council Fathers that Pope Pius V gave us the traditional Latin Mass as we have come to know it and love it. No, Pope Pius V did not introduce a new Mass to be named after himself. If he had ever made the slightest attempt to do that, none of his successors on the throne of St. Peter would ever have entertained the idea of canonizing him as an official saint of our church. And that is precisely what Pope Clement XI did in 1712, when Pope Pius V was proclaimed St. Pius V, henceforth to enter the history books as the Pope of the True Mass, as well as the Pope of the Rosary. The Mass and the Rosary, the True Mass and the Rosary. What an unbeatable combination. Let me repeat it. St. Pius V did not introduce a new Mass. All he did was to eliminate from the then existing Latin Mass the ever so lengthy devotional prayers, which on their own initiative, well-meaning, but sometimes overly devout bishops and priests over the centuries had added to the Mass they had inherited. St. Pius V's historical intervention thus resulted not in forcing a Novus Ordo, New Order Mass upon the Church, but in bringing back in all its solemn simplicity the very old Mass. so old that some of its ceremonies and prayers date back to the very days of our Lord and his disciples, and to the Roman catacombs, where the first Latin masses were offered 1900 years ago. Not on tables, but on the tombs, the stone graves of the martyrs. The martyrs, the first members of our church. Those beautiful men and women, those beautiful boys and girls who preferred death to betrayal or compromise of their and our beliefs. The apostolic constitution by which St. Pope Pius V brought back the original Latin Mass was dated July 19, 1570, and like all such pontifical documents is known by its first Latin words, in this case quo primum. Its complete text became an integral part, its very first page as a matter of fact, of the official Roman Missal, which the same Pope ordered in perpetuity and for all times, he said, as the only Mass book from then on ever to be used in the celebration of the Mass. Very rare indeed are the occasions in history when a Pope unequivocally tells the world that he is using the fullness of his apostolic authority as supreme pontiff of Christ's church to issue a decree binding in perpetuity and for all times, and threatening those who would dare to violate it, not just with excommunication from the church, but with God's very own vengeance. One such rare papal decree was St. Pius V's quo primum dealing with the traditional Latin Mass, and I quote, literally translating from the Latin text in front of me. By this our decree, to be valid in perpetuity, we determine and order that never shall anything be added to, omitted from, or changed in this missal. At no time in the future can a priest ever be forced to use any other way of saying Mass. And so as to preclude once and for all any scruples of conscience and fear of ecclesiastical penalties and censures, we herewith declare that it is in virtue of our apostolic authority that we decree and determine that this our present order and decree is to last in perpetuity and can never, never be legally revoked or amended at a future date. And if anyone would nevertheless ever dare to attempt any action contrary to this order of ours, given for all times, let him know that he has incurred the vengeance of the blessed apostles Peter and Paul, and of Almighty God himself. Friends, it is by virtue of that apostolic decree quo primum, and standing on the solid, dogmatic, moral, and canonical grounds this decree provides, and as a former major seminary professor who served as theological and canonical advisor in Rome during the Second Vatican Council, I should be capable of correctly evaluating such documents. It is by virtue of that apostolic constitution given for all times that I am offering the traditional Latin Mass today in exactly the same way I did it for the first time almost half a century ago, when my mother the Church gave me and all her priests this unique, bilaterally binding and irrevocable privilege, a privilege and contract I intend with God's grace to hold on to and live by, as I solemnly swore, till the last breath of my life.